I think what you have taught us when we came for that one day whole workshop in Mumbai, I think you summarized in this whole session. I know that is a more detailed discussion
Of course.
given, but I'm sure that our audience must have taken a lot of value out of it. But I think we need to we can ask a few questions each other, and same time a few questions I have already got from the people. So we will start with questions like the very question which you started with: what is the best mutual fund? I think this is the one question all of us want to know, right? That what is the best mutual fund I can invest right now? So for that, what will be?
Yeah, okay. So, and thanks. I think this is one of the most frequent questions, frequently asked questions that you and I all come across. As I said, the word best does not tell me anything at all about what the person is seeking. Whoever is the questioning, asking that question, what are you seeking? So then I probed further in a few cases. So eventually what they want is, the best mutual fund is one that gives highest returns.
Okay,
I said wonderful. What do you mean by highest returns? For what period? These are open-ended mutual funds. So do you want highest return for 1 year, next 1 year, or highest returns for next 5 years? Nobody can predict that. But the moment somebody looks at the highest returns, and the mind starts working at the available information, and that available information is only about historical past returns, historical highest returns. And as we all know, right now as we speak, last 1 year return from stock markets have been higher than something else. Does it mean today's stock market is the best investment compared to anything else? No, if I need money after 1 month, then I have to go with liquid funds. There's no question of going with equity funds. So this is something that we forget. And that's why, as I said earlier, there's nothing called the best fund. It is the most appropriate scheme given my situation. How do I select the appropriate scheme? First, I have to define my goals and risk profile, and then look at the asset category that can help me in achieving my goals given my risk profile. Within asset category, then I have to select a scheme based on various parameters that we talked about.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. I hope that this is something which all of the taken it because there is no such right scheme. It's all about you, how much affordability you have to kind of own that particular mutual fund. Okay.
Absolutely.
So one thing which one question came here also, I think this is as a new person, a person who has invested in mutual funds so far. So what is the one quick advice you can give to that person in order to start into mutual fund journey?
Well, somebody who's not invested in mutual funds so far, if I understood correctly, right?
So far he has not.
Fair. So, I normally use an analogy in such a case. So let me use the travel analogy, that if I want to travel from Mumbai to, let's say, Dubai, and I'm specifically choosing Mumbai and Dubai because there are actually only two ways you can travel, either by sea or by air. Everything else is impractical. So I have two options. One is I buy a plane myself and fly it myself. I get all the flexibilities that I want, whatever time I want to take, whenever I want to start, subject to airport approvals, but I can fix my schedule. Okay, but I need four things. Number one, I need to know how to fly an aircraft. Number two, while flying the aircraft, I have to pay full attention to the task of flying the aircraft. I can't do anything else. Number three, once could be okay, but if I have to do frequently, I mean, 3-4 times a year or maybe 10 times a year, then I should also enjoy doing it. I also need to enjoy affiliated tasks like, aircraft maintenance or cleaning or whatever else may be required. Okay. And the fourth, I should have enough money to be able to own an aircraft. These are the four conditions. So suppose that if all the four conditions are met, then it could be fun to fly myself. But if not, then I have to go to a professional. Option number one, I charter a plane. I retain a lot of flexibilities, but the flying controls are in the hands of the professional. But that also is costly. So the third option is to board a commercial aircraft and fly. That's the third option. Now, in the context of investing, the first option is managing your portfolio yourself. Deciding which stocks to buy, which bonds to buy, which property to buy, when to sell, what to sell, etc., etc., and doing all the affiliated work. So you manage your portfolio yourself is equivalent to flying your plane yourself. Option number two, chartering a plane, is portfolio management services. You hire a manager, but all the investment decisions are taken by the manager. You make it customization, but the cost is still reasonably high. And the third option, boarding a commercial aircraft, is mutual fund, where you have to go as per the schedule that they have fixed. But the ticket is very cheap and you get a comfortable seat. Now take your pick. I'm not saying what you need to do.
I think this is one thing which we all need to understand, that, you know, we need to understand that what you want and what is the best available in the market.
So a lot of times, Nikhil, discussions happen by focusing on part of the picture, which is where I can buy the stocks myself. Why do I need mutual funds? Yeah, so you can buy yourself. There are operational conveniences available, but can we really do it for a long term? And by long term, I'm saying for many of us, it's going to be 30, 40, 50, 70 years. Can you do it for that period?
You know, this is the one question we have even here also. Anyway, we don't really talk about any particular company in as such. But there's a question came up, like there is a situation like a small case. They're talking about that kind of, people are getting confused at small case. Is it a mutual fund? Is it a new scheme? So what is your view on investing in a small case versus a mutual fund?
So small case is gaining popularity of late. And if you just sit down and look at various small case portfolios which are available, some are well-researched portfolios recommended by some experts, but some are simply sector portfolios. So there are portfolios like, private banks portfolio or HDFC group portfolio. Now, HDFC group stocks, I don't need small case. I can simply go and buy the HDFC group stocks. I don't need small case. So when you are looking at small case, understand that you are going to small case because you are seeking an expert's help. Take that expert's input in how the portfolio is created. If it is simply on the basis of a formula, you don't need that small case. You can simply buy it yourself. Small case offers that operational convenience of simultaneously buying that. Number two, also check if the small case facility is offered by a broker. Is the broker making money by too many frequent transactions? So while you save the cost of mutual fund, you may end up paying the broker. Evaluate that and then take a call. Otherwise, small case has emerged as a fantastic alternative of late. And I would not generalize whether it is good or bad. You need to evaluate that also. In comparison to a small case, a mutual fund, I really don't have much issue as far as the regulatory structure is concerned. It is extremely robust in nature. So to that extent, I would still prefer mutual funds over small case simply because of the regulatory comfort. But if you were to go to small case, then you are only taking, going somewhere on the road and asking somebody for directions. Now, whether that person can actually give you proper directions or not, you need to check that.
Okay. Thank you. I think it's very clear that we have a system where it's well regulated and qualified people sitting and doing it. Then why you want to go with without having all these regulations and everything? Okay, thank you. I think there is a question. I know that what will be your answer, but I think this is. Can you pick three mutual funds, at least the schemes, on a below criteria? One is that long term, 10 times high risk, a long term, 10 years safe, moderate risk, short period less than 5 years, low risk, high liquidity.
So I will not name the individual schemes, but I can give an indication of the in terms of categories that you may want to look at. First is 10 years or longer and high risk category.
High risk, yeah. 10 year high risk. So,
yeah, 10 years and high risk category. So let's look at that. So with the 10 year and high risk horizon, I would say look at a flexi cap or mid-cap portfolio. But if you are a little conservative, then look at large-cap portfolio. Okay. I'm not suggesting small-cap in this particular case. Yes, specifically because a small-cap may require some amount of expertise in picking the right manager.
Okay, so I'm
not recommending that.
Mm-hmm.
10 years and...
10 years, safe, moderate risk.
Okay. So safe or moderate risk would be, yeah. So partially answered, look at a large cap category, or you can look at a large cap index fund, or you may also want to check out on another category known as balance advantage funds. So that's another category that you may check out on. So that's the less on the risk side compared to flexi cap or a mid cap portfolio, but for long term it could be good. And third is less than 5 years, low risk and high liquidity. Now, less than 5 years is slightly tricky because 1 month is less than 5 years and 4.5 years is also less than 5 years. So I need to break that period into a couple of buckets even further. So if your horizon is less than 1 year, then look at a liquid fund or ultra short term kind of a fund or money market fund, safe, highly liquid. But if your horizon is, let's say, 1 to 3 years, then you may want to look at something known as short term income funds or short term debt funds, or maybe dynamic bond funds. However, when you look at these categories, in both the less than 1 year as well as 1 to 3 years categories, check the credit rating profile of the portfolios.
Okay.
Try to pick up schemes which are more towards AA, AAA rated papers and less, below AA. For 3 to 5 years, I would simply say look at a corporate debt fund or a banking and PSU debt fund as a category. So that could be reasonably okay.
Fine. I when we get into this any category, the question here is that what about will buyer it, or how often we do monitor that?
So sorry, I missed a couple of words. If you can repeat the question.
when you get into the schemes, when you we have given the three scenario and we have picked, and I think here will be a confusion that should we buy and forget it or should we buy and monitor it? I think you have already mentioned that, but I think if we can specify that, how often we need to monitor that, that will be great.
Okay, so let's take the example of the three categories or three, four categories that we talked about and then answer this particular question. Typically, it is good to do a portfolio review once every year. However, before we do the portfolio review, first you have to do the review of our own situation. What has changed in our own situation? So broadly, there are five things that we need to financial things, and the sixth is the risk profile that we need to talk about. The five financial things are my income level, expenses, my assets, my liabilities, and my financial goals. Okay, these are the five financial things that I would ask everybody to check first. Is there a change in any of these? My risk profile, has it undergone a change or not? Yeah. So now take, for example, a lot of times there are changes in the family situation. For example, say somebody's daughter finished her education and now got a job. So as far as the family is considered, one expense, which was the education expense, has gone down and income has got added to the family. So that would get incorporated, or let's say my loan was repaid completely. So my expenses towards EMIs have gone down, so and my savings would go up to that extent. So you look at those five things financially, and sixth is the risk profile. Mm-hmm. Once you've done that review, then do you need to make any changes in your asset allocation? And then comes the question of schemes. Now, let's look at the three questions that were asked about the time horizon.
Yes.
We broke the five-year period into less than 1 year, 1 to 3 years, and 3 to 5 years. And the other period was 10 years. Now, let's start with something that was 4.5 years away, a financial goal that was 4.5 years away when you started investing. 2 years down the line, it is 2.5 years away. So now you can't remain in the 3 to 5 years category. You've got to shift into 1 to 3 year category, because the time to goal has come down. So you do a review accordingly and make changes, and then do the evaluation whether the scheme still fits into my requirements or not.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Good. And here there is another point, like, situations like now it's at market peak, and when we investing that at this situation, what we should do? Do we exit, or what is the kind of asset allocation we have to do? That is another point you may need to touch here.
Asset allocation often is seen from two perspectives. One is outward focused, which is where the markets are, what is the outlook, etc. The second is inward focus, which is my situation, my requirement, my financial financials, etc., etc. I prefer the inward looking approach far better than the outward looking approach, simply because it is easier to do my own evaluation than to do the world's evaluation. Mm-hmm. And forecasters have shown a miserable track record of forecasts. They are neither consistently right, nor consistently wrong. So, had they been consistently wrong, then also I was okay that I can just simply pick up their forecast and do the reverse. But they are not even consistently wrong. So it's been an erratic track record. So can't really depend on the forecasters. So I start with my own situation and do the asset allocation, which you discussed already in detail. But within that, now, should we factor into something tactical, or what is happening outside, so markets at a high or low, etc., etc.? So what will happen is, when I've done my internal analysis, those five financials and my risk profile, and based on that, now my portfolio, and let's look at a particular financial goal only, not the comprehensive portfolio, but for a particular financial goal, I arrived at a portfolio which says I should be, and let's say it's a long-term portfolio, I should be 70% into equity and 30% into fixed income. It's just an example. Sometime later, when I sit down to review that portfolio, if the equity markets have gone up, then that 70% equity is likely that it could have become 75, 77, 80, whatever it is. And the debt would have commensurately come down in terms of percentages. I'm not talking about value, I'm only talking about percentages. In that case, simply rebalance back to 70-30.
Mm-hmm.
So if equity is 80%, then I would sell 10% equity from my portfolio and shift it to fixed income. So what typically happens is I've already booked profit when equity markets are at high. In the reverse situation, if equity had gone down to 65 and debt to 35, I would have shifted 5% from debt to equity and rebalanced back to 70-30. So at lower levels of equity, I would have bought equity.
Okay.
This is one way where you can shift money from one to the other and do the rebalancing. The other way of doing it is depending on your cash flow. So when you got additional money, invest money in such a manner that you are able to rebalance back to the desired percentage allocation. When you need money, you withdraw from the asset, which has appreciated far more than your expectation, so which was higher. So take, for example, if I were to do this asset allocation, and if I were, for the sake of example, I'm picking up March 2020 end. If I, had some surplus money at that point in time, I would have put that money into equity. Or if I am looking at right now, and if I got surplus money, the chances are high that I would buy debt. But if I need money for some expenses, I would take that money out of equity.
Okay.
So this is how I would rebalance the portfolio.
So here, the question is that now the invested equity schemes are performing well.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not the question of whether I need money or not. So at this point of time, should I exit that value which is showing in peak, or should I?
So whether something is at peak or not will only be known in hindsight. I mean, simply look at January 2020, just a year back, 14th January 2020, Sensex was closer to 42,000. Mm-hmm. And that was the peak. It was the highest point historically. Right. And nobody thought that this would see a fall in the markets later. When you looked at February or March, then that day was a peak. Today, in January 2021, we are far higher than that point, roughly 20% up above that point, right? So whether something was at the peak or not can only be known in hindsight. And it's difficult to foresee in advance. Look at the amazing thing that happened in this year. Absolutely, most people are flabbergasted. In fact, Dr. Raghuram Rajan, he gave an interview, and then yesterday it was published in newspapers that the movement in stock market is hiding the pain in the economy, something of that sort, he said. And that's absolutely right, because all the indicators of economy are showing that there is stress and the market is at all-time peak. So very often, experts like Dr. Raghuram Rajan also come up and say that I can't make sense of what is happening. He did not say in as many words, but this is exactly what he hinted. And why am I quoting Dr. Raghuram Rajan is because in 2008, he was one of the very, very few who called that there'll be a market crash. And it happened. Okay, so he's one of the few who could do that. And today he says, I don't know what is happening right now. I mean, economy is in pain. Now, if that's the case, whether it is peak or not, we just don't know. So I would rather not get into that guessing game. And what I would do is, again, go back to my desired allocation and see how much is the deviation from my desired allocation in my current portfolio, and simply rebalance. That's all I would do. I mean, it's too tempting to try and predict, and it is too brave to accept that I can't predict.
Thank you. I think it's all about, you know, it's something like we say, right? All this big thing, yes. We decide. Things like we discuss about. And Garka Gara, our wife will decide. What is that? So,
she'll decide.
I think that's the same thing.
Absolutely.
I think, you know, and another question we have is that, you know, when it comes to SWP, what is that efficient way, or you know, what is the kind of fund we can use it to set up SWP kind of investment?
So look at the purpose of that SWP. Why do you want to set up an SWP? When you need a regular inflow from your investments, that's when you set up a withdrawal plan. That can be the only purpose. So again, look at your own requirement. What kind of cash flow that you need? For how long do you need? Do you want a fixed income for the entire period, or you want the income to be rising over the years? Because let's say, for example, if I were to fund my daughter's education and the fees have to be paid, currently in her college, we pay fees thrice a year. So I know the schedule and I know the amounts also that I have to pay. Okay, so I simply do a withdrawal from my investments on those days and pay.
Okay.
Right, so that's one requirement. But if I were to fund my retirement, then I would need monthly cash flow. Mm-hmm. So for my daughter's education, it's quarterly. For my retirement, it's going to be monthly. And over a period of time, that monthly withdrawal also needs to keep rising because the cost of living keeps going up. Mm-hmm. So I need to set up my withdrawals accordingly. So if I define those goals, then it is easier to decide a withdrawal plan.
I think, you know, here most of the time what we are talking about is that purely based on that goal and the requirement, rather than looking to see that I'm getting some money out from the market or
yeah. So a lot of times people have actually expressed that, you know, it gives me a lot of comfort that some money comes into my account. Mm-hmm. Now that's okay. I mean, that also could be one of the reasons why one may want to set up a withdrawal plan. But then do as minimum as possible, because the moment you withdraw money from your investments, you are interrupting the process of compounding.
Mm-hmm.
You don't really want to interrupt that process as much. So whatever, even if compounding happens at 4% or 5%, the moment I withdraw some amount, the compounding for that amount stops. So what is the plan that I have for that, the money which I have withdrawn? Am I going to, and that's why I keep going back to the needs. If I don't need to spend that money, all I'm going to do is I'm going to reinvest it some way.
Okay.
If anyway, I have to reinvest, why do that entire exercise of taking money out of investment into bank and from putting it back from bank to the investments?
Yeah. I think we have a lot of plans like that. There are some scenarios like this. People take SWP and...
Yeah. And then do an SIP. Yeah. So instead, do what is known as STP, systematic transfer plan, from one scheme to the other, if you really want to shift from one scheme to the other. But otherwise, SWP and SIP, both, first compounding may stop in certain, that's possible if you are not doing anything. Or if you're also doing SIP, then also keep in mind that each SWP, there could be some exit load or tax. And when it comes to tax, there could be capital gains tax, there could be stamp duty that the funds have to now pay. So you are actually making the government of India rich by doing this.
You're contributing to the country.
Yeah.
And I think there is just to there are a lot of things like in SWP, there are people who invest in equity or balance fund. Then they take SWP, then they reinvest that same fund into similar hybrid fund. So that
yeah,
is
exactly.
Yeah, so that is, I think.
Yeah, actually, one needs to check whether that really serves a purpose or not. Yeah.
There are a lot of questions, but which is the best scheme, MF scheme, MF option for a one-time investment? Any option? Because there is no specific, so you have answered it, but just want to
a lump sum investment is what I understand, that I've got some money and I need to invest one time and I need to invest. Now there again it goes back to what's the purpose of that investment. If I'm investing one time and I need money next month, then I would say go to a liquid fund. But if I invest this money and if I'm investing it for the retirement to accumulate retirement fund for my 15-year-old son, okay, so then we are talking about a 55-year period. And then I would simply say buy a good flexicap fund and put money there. Don't worry about anything else. So the purpose is important. Again, if I'm already retired at 60. And I'm investing lump sum all my retirement corpus one time to fund my retirement expenses, then again the answer could be very, very different.
Yeah, I think it's all about being clarifying that what you really want out of it, and
what
based
you
on.
Really that,
yeah.
See,
I think
Nikhil, my request to everyone always has been, and wherever I've interacted with investors, is that money is not an end in itself. Money is a means to an end. The end is is living the life of your choice. So make those choices and use the money to help you fulfill those choices.
Okay.
And lot of clarity emerges then in that case. Lot of unnecessary activities and lot of unnecessary stressors go away.
Thank you. I think this is a very valuable lesson. I think if you read your book, the financial
lesson from ICU.
ICU, yeah, lesson from ICU. I think this serves that purpose. We have taken more than 20 minutes of your time.
If people are there and if there are questions,
people are very much there. There is one question.
Sure.
My advisor does switching between liquid to growth funds based on market. To growth when market is down, back to liquid when the market is up via STP and SWP. What is your view?
Well, this is similar to the rebalancing that we talked about. I think that's what somebody's trying to do. When the market is up or when the market is down, how does one decide is the question. So the rebalancing example that I used was based on the percentage allocation in the portfolio. Somebody may simply look at the market levels. Somebody may look at various valuation parameters in the market. So let's say price to earning ratio or price to book value ratio of Nifty or Sensex or whatever index that one is tracking. So these are some of the tactics that a few financial advisors do adopt. So long as it is rebalancing, I think that's not much of a problem.
Okay. And there are questions like, sometimes when we ask for a goal as such, when here also I can see some questions directly came to me, they don't have much of a clarity about what is the goal, but if we say that, okay, 1 crore rupees, I want to acquire in one, maybe 10 years time. So what is that kind of fund we have to allocate for this kind of investment?
So Nikhil, this is a question which is actually, subset of the financial goal question, right? So when it comes to financial goals, I define the need and then we work backwards as to how much money would be required for that need. Mm-hmm. In this case, the person who's asked this question is, okay, what I do with that 1 crore is none of your concerns, but I need 1 crore 10 years from now. I would say this is a fairly good goal statement for this particular person. So this is perfectly fine to have this kind of goal. The only question that I would have, additional question that I would have is this a critical need or responsibility, or is it a good to have goal, or is it simply a wish or a dream?
Okay.
It is defining the seriousness. If it is a dream or a wish, I can take higher risk on the portfolio. So if I achieve it earlier, I'll be happy. If I don't achieve, there'll not be much regret. But if it is a responsibility or a need, then I better turn a bit more conservative as far as that particular amount is concerned.
Oh.
And accordingly build the portfolio.
Okay.
Right? So 1 crore 10 years from now, generally speaking, if it is a basic need or responsibility, I would say, and assuming that you have a lump sum money to invest, you start with a large and mid-cap portfolio. There are funds in that category, large and mid-cap, or you simply take a large-cap portfolio and gradually keep reducing the equity allocation.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, as you come closer. So let's say for first 5 years, don't touch that equity allocation. But 5 years down the line, shift some money into corporate bond funds. Then get into the short-term income funds, get into the liquid funds. So keep reducing that so that in the last year of the goal, large part of your money is in liquid and short-term plans so that you are not at the mercy of stock market's gyrations. That's what I would say. But if it is a dream or a good-to-have goal, get into small cap or mid cap, and that should be okay. If you achieve that earlier, I mean, it's like, trying to hit 5 sixers in an over. If you can do it, great, glory to you. In the other case, it's like the last test match, which our batsman, played out to end in a draw, because that was the requirement at that point in time.
Thank you. And there is a question that someone want to invest in ELSS via SIP, and what are the points they have to consider before choosing the scheme?
ELSS is a tricky category because even within SEBI categorization, it simply says ELSS is an equity scheme, and all the definitions which are put are as per the IT Act's definition of which schemes are allowed under section. I mean, what kind of scheme should it be within ATC? To that extent, look at historical behavior of the portfolio. I'm not looking at the returns. I'm looking at how the portfolio has been. Is it largely large cap or largely mid cap, or whether the portfolio is concentrated or reasonably diversified, how often the stocks are changed from the portfolio. Look at some of those points. And then large cap portfolio, more diversified, lower turnover is generally a safer portfolio. But a small cap portfolio, high concentration and frequent changes in the portfolio is a very risky portfolio. So you then take a call on which kind of risk that you want to take. Having said that, the riskometer should come in handy as a starting point. You may decide that anything in the highest risk category you want to avoid, or you simply want to take the highest risk, your choice.
And definitely if a younger or a risk-taking person, they can definitely go for a scheme. But the question is that how well people will be deep dive and see that what is the portfolio each of the schemes has that.
Yeah, so to that extent, it's like, if I were to buy stocks myself without going to the mutual fund route, we talked about that plain example. You got to do deep dive into the each companies. You need to understand the business of the company. Similarly, if you have the time and inclination and ability to evaluate mutual fund schemes, you can always do it yourself. If you don't have, then there are mutual fund distributors available, financial advisors available. Take their help. They should be able to guide you. But keep asking them questions. Why somebody recommending something or not recommending something, what is the downside possible? A lot of times investors while taking decision, they look at the possible upside. I normally look at the possible downside, because in my mind, the entire business of investment management is risk management and nothing else. If you are able to manage the risk properly, then upside is yours to for you to take. But if you only focus on the upside, then risk strikes big and hurts a lot.
Okay. Here, one more thing. So when we touch upon advisor, so what is that mean? Because everyone has this question that direct and regular and everything. So where do you draw the line that I need advisor help and or should I be doing on myself?
I've read many newspaper articles on this debate between direct plans and regular plans. My biggest concern is that in almost all the places, they only highlight the cost difference. But let's understand, this is capitalism. No cost can survive if there is no benefit, some sort of benefit. Now that benefit could be some tangible benefit or a psychological benefit, which is okay. And it's like, let's say, should I spend on luxury items? Someone like me would feel that I don't need luxury items. But a lot of people have that psychological need to spend money on brands and stuff like that, which is perfectly fine. It serves certain need. Now, in this case, if there is a cost differential, am I getting enough value for the cost that I'm bearing? That's where the regular plan comes in. I'm bearing some cost, which is higher than the direct plan. So do I get commensurate value or not? On the other hand, evaluate the direct plan. So if I'm saving something, and how am I saving? I'm not taking help of somebody or not hiring a professional. Then what are the tasks and activities that I would need to perform in the absence of that professional? Can I afford to spend that much time? What is the value of my time if I were to spend the same amount of time in my profession or job? Or what is the psychological value of that time if I were to were able to spend it with my family, friends, and in my hobbies? Mm-hmm. I think that evaluation is far more important than only looking at the cost advantage.
Okay, thank you. I think it's bang on. We have almost. I haven't really picked each of the questions, but all the answers which you have given had the answer of those questions people have asked so far. So we are already 30 minutes exceeded. So anyone has any one? We'll go for one more question. If you think that the question you asked and the answer Sar has given. Is anything is missing link is there, you can put it in the comment box and I will go for that question and we'll wrap the show today.
Nikhil, there is one question from Mr. Sujit. I just noticed how to handle the situation like March for a retail investor in stock market. Yeah. Okay, so I think we did not discuss that. And that's a fantastic question, because what happened in March was unexpected. Mm-hmm. And part of the answer lies in this one word, which I've carefully chosen, unexpected. Why was it unexpected? Because I did not expect. That's why it was unexpected. And why did I not expect it? Well, that's for me to look inward and see why did I not expect it. So if I invest in equity markets, am I prepared to see 30-40% kind of drop? Historically, since the inception of Sensex in 1979, so we are talking about a 42-year period, roughly. I mean, a couple of months less. In a 42-year period, there have been seven instances, when the index has fallen by more than 30% from the peak. So seven times in 42 years is roughly once every 6 years. However, the interesting part is something on an average has been happening once every 6 years, but before 2020, it did not happen for 12 years. So that fall happened in 2008, and then it happened in 2020. Now, more than a decade is a long period to lure people into believing that the risk has reduced in the stock markets. And that's why a large number of people did not expect. That's number one. Point number two is a lot of new people who entered the stock markets in last one decade, they had not themselves seen it. Now, it's easy to say that people have learned it in the year 2020. Well, but you don't have to experience every event to learn it. There's something called history, read it. And history is recorded. A lot of stuff is recorded. What happened in the past, you may not be able to emotionally go through that roller coaster, but at least you can put things into perspective. Okay, this can happen. You're mentally ready. That's number one. Okay. Now this mental readiness is critically important. We highlight that equity you invest for long term, and within that long term there would be many such short terms. So this 42 year period that we are talking about, Sensex value of 100 has crossed 49,000. So it has gone up 490 times in 42 years. But within that journey of one becoming 490, there have been 7 instances where top to bottom, there is a 30% or bigger fall. So those short terms have happened, and this long term has also happened. And that is the intrinsic nature of equity markets. I have to expect that from the stock market. So this is mental readiness. We invest for long term, and in order to get those long term fruits, we need to stay invested in the short term. And there are two things required to stay invested in the short term. The first, which we elaborated in detail, is the mental ability, psychological ability to stay put through that turmoil. And the second is financial ability to stay invested during that period. And that financial ability can come only if my short and medium term needs are provided for. Then only I can stay invested for long term. And that's why keep equity for long term, debt for medium term, liquid for short term. The moment you do this kind of allocation, you have the ability to stay invested for long term. And after that, stop reading newspapers or watching TV channels if you can't handle that. Otherwise, read, take the perspective, and try and understand what is happening. But beyond that, don't get emotionally swayed.
Okay, okay. I think great. I think on a rude way, can we say it as if you are investing in equity, you should see the heart to see 30% down, and you should have the patience to wait.
Okay, so I started understanding some of the lessons a few years back, and I'm mentally prepared to see my portfolio, equity portfolio, going down by 50% any day, not 30.
50%. Okay.
Yeah, so that's the programming that you have to do yourself. Okay. So a 30% fall does not really look too big.
Okay.
If you're mentally ready for a 50% fall.
Very good.
And believe me, that 50% fall does not happen that often.
Yeah, yeah.
It's happened only 3 times in 42 years.
I think if it happens, should we have a surplus? Can I put that money back?
Exactly. Right? So it's happened 3 times in 42 years.
Very nice. There is one more question. I'm looking for my retirement. How much percentage of my cash in bank shall invest in mutual fund as a beginner?
Look at the other way around. If you are investing your retirement fund, what you need as a retired person is a regular income. But that regular income should be rising over the period. Number two, you also need access to your money and easy access to your money, because as a retired person, you don't need, don't want to run from pillar to post to access your own money. So what you're looking for is a combination of investments where the income could be regular and rising over the years. At the same time, if in case if you need, there is access to your money. That's point number one. Now, for that purpose, look at what are the investments that fulfill this kind of conditions, and look at a combination of that. Real estate, to my mind, definitely does not, because though there could be rental income which could be rising, there is no guarantee whether there'll be a tenant always at every point in time. What if the property is vacant? Then I'm only spending money and there is no rental income. So there's one, and I can't get rid of the property. I can't sell it easily. So if I need a large lump sum, my money is stuck. So keep that in mind. However, if you have a significantly large portfolio and a small part of the portfolio is invested in real estate, no problems. Gold, good idea. Gold is liquid, easily sellable. But imagine if another lockdown happens, all the jewelry shops would be shut. You can't go and sell your gold. Number two, there is no cash flow coming from gold. And if that's the case, all you are left with is financial markets where electronically you can transact. So your bank account, bank fixed deposits, and open-ended mutual funds, stocks, and bonds which are listed on stock exchanges. These are the avenues which are highly liquid. Now comes the income part. As far as the income is concerned, your fixed deposits can get you income. There are some traditional investments like senior citizen savings scheme or post office MIS, Vai Vandan Yojana. No, those are the avenues where you can get regular income, but these are regular income products, not rising income products. So you need to provide for that rising income, and that's where mutual fund can come in, and mutual fund can be utilized to add to that rising income through a systematic withdrawal plan from debt funds or liquid funds. Thirdly, because we are talking about retirement, and these days retirements are actually quite long. So if you retire at 60 or 65, consider that you are going to spend 20, 25, 30 years in retirement. And we've seen many nonagenarians, at least if not centurions. If that's the case, you are going to live that long. So 20, 25, 30 years is a long enough period where you also need to worry about purchasing power of your money. And for that purpose, some amount of money must get into equity markets to give you protection against against inflation. Now, in equity market, a better option is equity mutual funds and not direct stocks. Debt markets, if you want to do systematic withdrawal, again, debt mutual funds and liquid mutual funds would come in. So take care of your basic regular income through some of the government sponsored schemes. Keep some money in bank deposit, whether you keep in your savings account or bank deposit, your choice. But keep some money which is easily accessible. Even if you keep slightly larger amount, don't worry about not earning anything on that. It's your sort of mental peace account. And then look at liquid and debt funds to supplement your income. And especially provide for that growth in income, and then keep equity to protect against inflation. That's how, but what percentage? It depends on your actual assessment. Number crunching would be required in each individual case.
Sir, just a follow-up question from this person. We'll wrap up after this. If they are asking that they are a layman and they are hiring an advisor, or a company. So in that case, how frequently they have to monitor that? Can I just keep it with them and I don't bother? So what will be your view for that kind of situation?
No, I think invest some time in carefully choosing who you are dealing with. Okay, and I'm that's why I use the word invest some time. Do a little bit of background check, do some reference check, have a one-to-one discussion with the person who would be helping you, and try and understand that this person is serious about the business and tries to understand your requirement more than finishing the conversation. A lot of times people are in a hurry to generate sales, that may not be always in your interest. But somebody who's ready to spend enough time with you, I think that person automatically becomes a better choice. This is number one. Number two, also understand the why behind whatever somebody's recommending. The reason why somebody's recommending. So let's say if somebody says, invest in this. No, you can't tell me invest in this. You have to tell me why are you suggesting this. What if it doesn't work? What is the backup plan? So that's something that I would look for. Once you've done that, then I think I already answered that question earlier. You should do an annual review at least. In the initial period, you may want to do a quarterly or a half yearly review, which is okay. But then over a period of time, you can do an annual review. And that should be okay. But in these days of electronic communication, you can ask somebody to send you monthly updates through email, and that should be good enough.
Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you. I think we have covered almost all these questions, and before the session, I told that half an hour extra will take, but we have taken 45 minutes extra time.
But I must compliment Nikhil, you and everybody who was present. The quality of questions was awesome. So, and really, really loud interacting.
Thank you so much. I think we, on behalf of the group, we must thank you for taking the time out. I know that you are a very busy person, and I know that how much passion you have for this industry. And I think when a person like me listen to you, or when we read your articles, we add a lot of value to the way we think and the way we handle and invest our own money. So I thought that this will be a great session, and a lot of philosophy people will take away from this conversation for their, not only for investment, for their life also. Because one thing which I always respect you from the session which I have attended the first time, that was in NSE building. investment at do three session.
Right.
So he's connecting small things with the life and investing. So I'm sure that people would have taken from this.
Thank you so much.
Any final word you want to give to people before closing the session, sir?
I mean, there's nothing like final words, but I sincerely wish everybody great 2021 and beyond. Thank you so much. Thanks, Nikhil, for this opportunity. As I said, the quality of questions was awesome. Really loved answering the questions. Thank you so much. And I hope these answers and this session are useful to all. Thank you so much.
Thank you. So thank you all. Thank you all for attending the session.